Good morning. Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. What a joy it is for us to be able to gather and to worship. We welcome those of you who are here in Friendship Hall at Cook's United Methodist with us. And we certainly welcome those of you who are joining us by live stream, or you're finding us later on either the Facebook page for our church or on our YouTube channel. We feel your presence here with us, and we pray that God would unite us and use us for his glory. My name is Sandra Clay. I'm the pastor here, and we're blessed to have during the month of August Edna Vaughn serving as liturgist. You'll get to meet her in just a few moments. Just several announcements quickly before we begin our time together. You'll be able to see on the message board out front as you drive by this week. August the 7th, that's this coming Saturday, is an important day for our Boy Scout troop. Our United Methodist men chartered them, and so we have a pretty tight relationship. And so Troop 246 is going to be having a yard sale here on Saturday. If you have items that you would like to donate for that sale, there's instructions in your bulletin, or you can call the church office and we'll let you know when you can drop those off. Come and shop. Just remember, somebody else's junk will be your best treasure ever. So we hope that you'll come and support them. I would also remind you, we're still collecting school supplies. The summer has gone so fast, but school will be starting very soon, and we want to help our teachers out. And so if you can do that, bring those by the church. Would also remind you that we're still collecting food items, but they are for backpack programs. And so the 3 pounds of pinto beans would have been a good addition to my backpack as I was a kid, but that doesn't really fly with most of the kids around here. So food items that we're collecting right now have to do for the backpack program, so we thank you for that. Make sure that you mark your calendar if you have not already, August the 14th, which will be a week from this coming Saturday. Phenomenal time. We missed not having our talent show last year. So hamburgers, hot dogs, and talent show, and ice cream. It is going to be a night like you would not believe. I do want to say a quick word before we quiet our minds and hearts too. Many of you know about the change in the CDC's recommendations. We are not under a mandate here. Not by our local government and not by the federal government, but we are under the mandate of Christ. If we follow Jesus, our mission, as we will discover again today, is simply to love. And so we will be evaluating and communicating with our membership, and hopefully with everyone else that kind of listens in, what it is that we would expect of you. Would remind you that we have been very lax, but really what we expect now is in the hallways and coming through doorways, when we tend to be closer to one another, we will wear masks and ask you to do the same thing. When you get to your seat, when you get to your classroom, you can take your mask off there. But just as an example, one of our staff members has lost 2 family members to COVID, both fully vaccinated, but very ill, their immune system compromised. Well, they got it from somebody, probably who didn't know they had it. So let us love one another well. Watch for emails and for other communication, and thank you already for following Jesus. We are excited again that you are here. Let us worship God. Thank you.
you please stand for the invocation and remain standing for the call to worship? Those who can stand, we invite you to do it. Holy God, as we gather here in the harbor of your safety, we thank you for fellowship and family. We ask that you strengthen us, restore us, and inspire us with your love. Fill us with your peace so we may pour out our love and grace to others as you have poured it on us. May we take your promises to all the earth. Amen. We are called to be God's children.
God's love has been poured on us through Jesus Christ.
Fear and doubt be gone.
Joy and celebration ring in our hearts.
Come, let us raise our voices in song.
Let us offer our hearts and souls to God in prayer and praise. Amen.
Remain standing and sing with me our first song this morning, The Church is One Foundation.
From Acts chapter 3, 1 through 12. Peter and John were going up to the temple at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, the established time for prayer. Meanwhile, a man crippled since birth was being carried in. Every day, people would place him at the temple gate, known as the Beautiful Gate, so he could ask for money from those entering the temple. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he began to ask them for a gift. Peter and John stared at him. Peter said, "Look at us." So the man gazed at them, expecting to receive something from them. Peter said, "I don't have any money, but I will give you what I do have. In the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, rise up and walk." Then he grasped the man's right hand and raised him up. At once, his feet and ankles became strong. Jumping up, he began to walk around. He entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. All the people saw him walking and praising God. They recognized him as the same one who used to sit at the temple's beautiful gate asking for money. They were filled with amazement and surprise at what had happened to him. While the healed man clung to Peter and John, all the people rushed toward them out Solomon's porch, completely amazed. Seeing this, Peter addressed the people. "You Israelites, why are you amazed at this? Why are you staring at us as if we made him walk by our own power and piety?" This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Just in case you missed a word or two, and before the message self-destructs. Child of God, joint heir with Jesus, this is God's world, inherently good, devastatingly broken, yet never without hope. Jesus has made a way for everyone to know and grow in the love of God by faith. And Jesus is sending you to love in his name and by his power every ordinary day, right where you are, doing the things you do every day with the flair that only you have, loving everyone, everywhere, all the time, lest you miss an opportunity to love like God has loved you in Jesus. This is your mission, should you choose to accept it. That's exactly what we've been talking about for 12 weeks now. You are sent to be salt and light. You are sent to be seasoning, preserving the goodness of life and of all that God intends still, bringing healing to people and to activity to this entire world. You are sent to be light, illuminating the path, warming the given moment for others that they may feel and receive the love of God, attracting others by that light, not to yourself, but to Jesus. And we cannot avoid the question any longer. Will you accept your commissioning? I want us to look at that word for a moment, commission. That's not just the question that titles this sermon, but commission is exactly what Jesus has already given us in Matthew, the 28th chapter. We're not going back there. You've heard me say enough, phrase by phrase, over these past weeks, what it is that we have been sent to do. But what exactly is a commission? A commission is an instruction. It's a command or a duty given to a group or a person. A commission is also the act of committing an act. Now, we often use that word to speak more of crimes or offenses, but could you, as a child of God, one who calls themselves by the name of Jesus, could you be accused of committing such an act that brings salt and light to the world? A commission is also a warrant that confers rank or assignment for someone. A commission is a group of people officially charged with a particular function or a particular role. No matter how we use that word, it comes from the Latin, which means to entrust. And in this case, Jesus is entrusting the will of God to you and to me. The reason why I use the word commission is because it's the same work that Jesus was sent to accomplish. It is the same mission. And just a reminder, Jesus himself said to that first generation of disciples, but he says it to us today too, you will do even greater things. And so please hear, my friends, the commission that Jesus offers to us, sends us to accomplish, feels like it's mission impossible. I have a young friend who is young no longer, bless her heart, bless my heart, because that makes me feel really old. But in a children's event at her home church, she came and crawled up in my lap with her 12-year-old long legs about the time the music in the movie we were watching sounded like that. And she looked at me and said, it's never good when the music changes. The music of our life often feels like the Mission Impossible theme song, but this is very much Mission Possible. It really is just whether you will accept it or not. But be clear, your commissioning does not separate you from others, but it does set you apart. Did you notice, as Edna read for us today, Peter and John were going to the temple to pray at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. You've heard that before in the last couple of weeks. Cornelius was observing Mincha whenever the notion came to him from God's angel about Peter being close by. Peter and John were on their way, like they do all the time when they're in Jerusalem and can get to the temple. They were doing their ordinary thing, daily activity, given over to God, and something happened on the way. That's the way this mission works. Are we to say that we believe Peter and John were the only Jesus followers there at that time? Oh, I don't know. I don't believe that's exactly what Scripture is saying, but it's clear that they were the only ones on mission when the man who had been asking for alms since he was at the age of accountability, because he had nothing else to offer his family. They were the only ones that heard and so responded the way that they did. Be very clear, your commissioning by Jesus the Christ does not separate you from others. He's not going to send you someplace that you are not prepared to go. But he does set you apart. And in that setting apart, you already have all that you need to be on mission with Jesus and to be effective. This man had been crippled since birth. This is all he's known since the age of accountability, is the beautiful gate. And especially at the time when folks would come to the temple for prayer, for worship, for sacrifice, he drew on the presence of those tender-hearted. Those who were tender-hearted belonged to God. They were prepared to give of themselves. And in that moment, they all worked to help sustain him and his family, whatever shape that they were in. And I love Peter's audacious response. Well, I ain't got no money, but listen here, I'm gonna give you what I got. Most of us would separate an opportunity such as that. If I don't have what you ask of me, then I am moving on. But what Peter did was to begin with looking at that man with the eyes in his head and the eyes of his heart. And in order to be able to give, Peter had to be clear about what he had. He saw that man with his eyes and with his heart. He was clear already about the power of Christ. He was daring enough in that moment to proclaim healing with confidence, and he spoke a prayer believing that it would happen. He'd seen it happen before. And then he helped the man stand. That's pretty audacious. To proclaim that healing could happen rise up and walk. This man was an adult who had never been inside the temple. Not because people couldn't get him there, but because he wasn't allowed there. He wasn't allowed there because the religious order of the day, she says with sarcasm, the religious order of the day said that indicated some kind of brokenness in that broken man, and he was not going to come into the temple and potentially defile it for everyone. Know who you are and what you have. That's the example of Peter's life right then. He knew he was an amazing masterpiece with gifts and abilities given only by the Holy Spirit. He was created in the very image of God and so good to the core, even when he got it wrong. Because he was gifted by the Spirit, he also was rife with wisdom from the life that he had lived so far, most of it well lived. And he was empowered by God's Holy Spirit in that very moment to be evidence of love, mercy, and grace in the world. His little s spirit, the spirit he was given when he was born, was one of power and love. And then you pile the Holy Spirit on top of that. And he had sensitivity to the movement of the Holy Spirit. That's what enabled him to see that man with his eyeballs and with his heart. Do you use your eyeballs and your heart when you're walking into Publix or going to work or responding to your children or to your spouse or to that neighbor? Know who you are, my friends, and what you have, and then give it freely. I want you to get that image in your mind if you can. This was the first time this man, whose legs are now made strong, the first time he has entered the temple, and he does so leaping and running and dancing and shouting. And scripture says that he was clinging to Peter and John, not because his legs weren't strong enough yet, but because he was going where he never believed he could go. He stopped that a long time ago. He was living small when Peter and John walked by, there to do what he does every day of his life, asking for help to just get by. Peter knew what was possible because of God. Why would he not share that? But I want you to be convinced, my friends, of how simple it really is. You've heard me say before, I have a good friend named Barbara who told me that her hesitation in receiving the full grace, full measure of the grace of God was, I just know it, he's going to send me to China, and I don't want to go to China. Well, he hasn't sent her to China yet, but I will tell you, I think this is funny, I will tell you what he's done, is she has served as a caterer to two refugee ministries in the heart of Memphis, and most of the people that she serves are from Asian countries. And so there you are. Told you, Barbara. For us to know who we are, for us to know who God is, for us to know what we have with us in the moment and then be willing to give it freely is not so hard as we believe that it is. It does matter how we do those things. So I want to offer you two examples that I've seen in life in the last few days. But the first is how not to do it. It's from my own life. Eric is going to display a text in just a moment, and as he puts those words on the screen. Let me say that I have been the recipient over the last 6 weeks or so of some pretty nasty group texts. You may be receiving those too. Sometimes it's just to sell stuff, and sometimes it's very vulgar. I'm going to read it to you, and then I'm going to make a confession, so there you are. I'm looking, Eric. Lord God, I pray for all those receiving and sending these texts. I pray for them to feel your abiding presence around them and within them. Surround them with your light and deliver them to the fullness of your design and your desire for their lives. Even more, deliver them to the fullness of the love you have for them. In the name of Jesus, amen. In the moment that I sent that the first time, honestly, I thought, I'm going to invoke the name of Jesus. That'll make them shut up. That's the same thing the disciples did when that Syrophoenician woman whose daughter was dying came to them, and she began to shout, and they said, could you just send her away? She's driving us nuts. My intention was to drive them away, not to love them. And the conviction came yesterday when I was invited to hook up with somebody. And I hit paste with a bit of an evil grin on my face. And within 10 seconds, I got a response, just a little heart in the corner of the text. And then I got a direct response from that number that said, thank you. I had forgotten that I was not forgotten. Being present in the moment, my friends, is all God is asking us to do. And if you are convinced that you are loved by God, if you know that love is something that cannot be taken away, then every moment, every activity, every word, every relationship is fair game for us to be on mission. By now, you may know the names of Lily King and Annie Laser. Though they have been impressive in the Olympic pool this week, I don't want to talk about their racing. I want to talk about this. Lily King has much more experience than Annie Laser does. As a matter of fact, after one brief entree into collegiate swimming, she retired. She began to work as an intern at UCal Berkeley and felt like she had abandoned herself. So one more shot in 2018, she went back to Indiana, accepted to the program there, and that's where Lily King was also swimming as a collegiate athlete. They worked together to encourage one another, and in 2019, for the very first time, Annie Laser swam competitively at the Pan American Games, and she medaled. She did really well. She was ready for her attempt to make the Olympic team, and as we all know, 2020 was a year, so the games were postponed. But Annie Laser took it as a challenge to get even better with every passing day, so that whenever this opportunity came back around, she would be ready. On Sunday, April 25th, Sunday, April 25th, 2021, with no expectation at all, because there had not been any sickness, Annie Laser, the one on the right, heard that her dad had died at 61. Lily drove over 8 hours to be able to attend the funeral of her friend's father. And before leaving, after that celebration of life, she whispered in Annie's mom's ear, I'm going to do whatever I can to help her make the team. It was less than 6 weeks later. She's supposed to be swimming, Annie is, to be able to make it to the Olympic team. And so here they are at trials. King has already swum fast enough to qualify for the team. And on the 200-meter breaststroke, they are in adjacent lanes. Laser, the one who is grieving, and matter of fact, by her own testimony, says most days leading up to that event, I was choosing either to swim or to grieve, but I could not do both. And standing in adjacent lanes, the one on the right is strong enough because of the love from the one on the left, and she's the one who winked at Lily King and said, I love you. Thank you for loving me. Let's do this. And when they both hit the water, the one who was the weakest was 68/100ths of a second faster than the one on the left, the one who'd already qualified. She beat her own personal best, and she was, by that race time, the third fastest in the world for 2021. Yeah, you better believe, let's do this. Let's do this because of the love poured into her before and after something unthinkable for many of us. Every day in the pool, crying over the loss of her dad and trying to get in the lane and do her best. And all Lily King did, I don't know what her relationship with Jesus is, but as one who knows Jesus, I see the love of God in those two. I hope they know what they have and who they are so they can keep on doing this. And I want you to know what you have done already so that this next young one becomes an example for you. And so this is, you know Kaylee. You don't know Lainey, probably, unless you've been with me to the goat farm. I know that's not a goat. That is a llama. But the llama lives with the goats, so there. I took Kaylee and Michael and their grandmother to my happy place a couple of weeks ago. And I did not get a picture of Kaylee the way I wanted to, but it wasn't appropriate in the moment. And so you might have to close your eyes to picture it if you've never been to Harmony Lane. But there's an enclosure that's air conditioned, where you get to hold on to the newest little babies. And there were goats that were less than 2 weeks old. And so Kaylee and Michael were, well, Kaylee was still, still enough to hold that little goat close to her. And about the time we really did get settled, a family comes in, mom and dad, whose names we never learned, and Travis. Travis is about 30. And he resides in a wheelchair when he's awake. He has no function, no use of his lower body. And the function of his upper body is limited. He does not speak. He makes noises that are pretty distinguishable. I mean, you can tell which ones are happy noises and which ones are not. Michael, I don't know that Michael saw a difference between those of us who could stand and this one named Travis who could not. He abandoned his goat to run around the room on her own so that he could go and give Travis a hug. But when Travis reached out for Kaylee, she was not wearing that smile. The grunt and the sudden movement was not familiar to her. And so she scooted almost instinctively up underneath my right arm. And so as she stroked that baby goat, Lily, I just whispered to her. What I said was, you know, Travis isn't like you and me. He's made in the image of God. But though he is an adult, he still thinks like a very little kid. He can't walk and he can't talk like us. And I think he just wants a hug from you like Michael gave him. But you don't have to do that if you're not comfortable. She kind of scooted out from underneath my shoulder. And she announced that she was done cuddling. She wanted to go meet some of the other animals. Thus the picture with Lainey. We were all headed out the door. And Kaylee put on the brakes. I mean, almost immediately. And turned around and ran over to Travis and gave him a hug. And she said, "I'm glad to meet you." And then left. Kaylee never even saw the smile on that man's face. She knew who she was and what she had in that moment, and she gave it freely. It's that simple. This mission of doing and being Jesus in front of everyone else is that simple. You and I are sent. We are sent to be salt and light every ordinary moment, so that the extraordinary life and joy of God is unleashed everywhere, in the cuddle barn at a goat dairy, in the produce section at Publix, standing in line behind a slow clerk when you're at Target, wherever you are, working with that coworker who never pulls their own weight, working with those classmates who drive us nuts, and dealing with our neighbors who are slow on the uptake. Sent to be salt and light every ordinary moment of the life God gave you, that the extraordinary life of God would be unleashed everywhere. This is your mission, should you choose to accept it. Will you live into your commissioning? Thanks be to God.
So many different ways that we can do it now. One, our offering basket is available at the exit for those who would like to leave your offering, or you may continue to make donations by mail, by bank draft, or visiting our website, www.cokesumc.org, or by texting CUMC to 73256, or drop by the church during normal office hours and you get to visit with Monica a little bit. Let us pray. Almighty God, giver of all gifts, grow in us the wisdom to know that all we have to give is because you have given to us first. Remind us that you have called us to be gentle, patient, and loving with all. May the gifts we have been given and the gifts we share reflect our gratitude for your many blessings. We pray this in your holy name. Amen.
You to take note, if you have not already, of those prayer concerns that are listed in our bulletin. I think they'll also be on the screen, but you can certainly find those in the email that includes our bulletin that we send out to members. If you're not sure whether you're on that email list, then we encourage you to be in touch with the church office so we can do that. We'll just remind you all of the names that are listed there. Amanda Beckham has surgery scheduled early week. We also know that Sandra Carney is still in the process of recovery. At the same time, she's supposed to be getting her classroom together. Charlie is at home with new meds and to help her feel better and to keep her out of the hospital. So we pray for Charlie and the effectiveness of that medication. Want to also ask you to be in prayer for Brenda, who is a dear family friend of Monica's, and they've had a loss in their family just in these last days. Let me tell you, too, if you've not heard, Michael Goff, who is the son of Reverend Craig Goff, was scheduled to have surgery, and they had to put that off, and so his surgery didn't happen until about 4 o'clock yesterday afternoon, and we have still not gotten an update, but we have no reason to believe that the surgery wasn't successful and effective. He's in L.A., was hit by a car during work hours, but he is doing well, and so we're praying not only for Michael's healing, but also for Craig, who can't get to his son real quickly, so thank you for remembering them. And certainly, Kathy Stutzman is having surgery at the beginning of the week. And so we know already we're going to be jumping and shouting and thanking God for health for her. But certainly our hearts are sad today as we remember the family and friends of Carolyn Drummond. Her services will be this coming Thursday, 2 o'clock to 3 o'clock visitation right here in this room of the Friendship Hall of Cooks United Methodist, and then the service immediately following at 3. So remember her family and friends, also the family and friends of Ryan Mudry, of Glenda Paris, and of Harold Sutton, who are all a part of the Church Triumphant, as we call their names today. Would you join me as we... Oh, and Holly is on a plane. See, you didn't scream it out, Miss Lynn. I've got Holly's name written right here. I've read it 3 times in my mind, and it never made it out of my mouth. Holly is on a plane as we speak. Is that correct? On her way home after blah, 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 like 3,000 years. Isn't it like that? 2 years. 2, 3,000, whatever. All right. So from China.
Japan.
Yes, I started to say close enough, and I want to apologize for that because I know there's a big difference. But she's been on mission, and so we're excited that she's on her way back home. And so we're going to put Holly in that long flight, and all of those who are caring for her. That's a happy thing for us to thank God for. Would you join me as we go to God in prayer? Indeed, we are so grateful, O God, for the simple ways that others have spoken words of life into our minds, into our hearts. Those of us who have been taught by Sunday school teachers and by neighbors and friends, those who have come alongside us and taught us to open our eyes and our ears for that of God, which is not so dramatically obvious, but still so fundamentally true. We ask that you would give us the kind of confidence Peter and John had, not thinking about what they didn't have to be able to offer that man at the beautiful gate or anybody else. They were so focused on what they did have that they could not wait to give it away. And so often we are focused on what we don't have or what we don't have enough of, that we forget who and whose we are. Maybe be bold enough and audacious enough to want to extend hugs to folks like Travis. Maybe we encourage and applaud and learn from those who are willing to give hugs away, like Kaylee. Teach us, O God, the power of every moment, every person, every opportunity, that indeed love would rule the day. We thank you for being the strong and abiding presence in the lives of those who are ill, who are facing surgery, who are recovering from surgery, those who are facing diagnoses, if not protocols and treatments that will upend their lives. Our faith is firm in this one who gave his life for us. Thank you, God, for loving us so well. It is in the name of Jesus that we pray, and all God's people say, amen. We're going to prepare now to come to the table and to partake of the sacrament of God's grace, we call communion. Some traditions call it the Eucharist. the great Thanksgiving. We come to this table knowing that it has been set by love. If you are joining us by live stream or you find us at a later time, know that you are invited to partake as well. Just find whatever constitutes an element there, something like bread, something like juice, and join us as we come to the table together. Before we begin the liturgy, that helps us center ourselves on the very gifts of God, we will be partaking with individual pieces of bread and a cup that you will choose. We will come down the center aisle, and there will be one station for bread. I will pass that piece of bread to you, so if you'll come with your hands like such, and then you will go towards the side you came from to be able to receive a cup. There's a basket at the end of either prayer bench for you to put your empty cup in. If you would prefer to have one of those cups that has the seal that protects a wafer and the cup in, we have plenty of those as well. And we practice an open table in the United Methodist tradition. You need not be a member of this congregation, nor this denomination, in order to be welcome here, for this is the table of our Lord. Would you hear this invitation? Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another even now. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Would you hear the good news? Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. As we begin to share in the great Thanksgiving, I invite you to open your hearts and offer them to God with me. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and Jesus said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and Jesus said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered in this place and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray in the way Jesus taught his followers to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, I'm going to invite first all of those who are going to assist this morning, and let me serve you first, and then a very quick reminder, we'll be taking by, you'll receive an individual piece of bread and the cup. You stay as long as you want to in front of the kneeler. Please don't kneel, but you can stand and pray, or you can go back to your seat and pray. There's a receptacle at the end of those prayer benches here for you to be able to place your empty cup if you would prefer. The sealed cup that has both wafer and juice, we would be glad to serve you one of those as well. And our ushers will help guide us. And so come if you're thank you. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself for us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our closing hymn is Crown Him with Many Crowns. We've got Sunday school classes that want to get on to doing those things, and so we will do two verses instead of three, the first and the third. So if you'll follow, you can follow your bulletin or follow the screen, either one. If you are hearing for the very first time that you have been invited, even commissioned to join Jesus on his mission, and you are ready to do that, we would love to celebrate with the newness of life that this change means for you. Please don't leave today, leave this hour, whether you're behind the screen or here with us. Please don't leave without letting someone know so you can be accompanied on this grand journey, especially as you begin a new relationship with Christ. Let us sing for his glory. To a hungry and hurting world. The peace and power of the Lord is with you now and forever. We accept the commissioning of Christ to go. Let's sing together. Great day.